Hi, my name is George and I'm from the Philippines. My topic is about 10 disruptions brought about the COVID-19. So I entitled this COVID-19 and the World to Come. Here's how far corporate profits could plummet in 2020. This is a report, forecast for that matter, given to us by experts from Forbes magazine. And we can see here the disparity of forecast of or decrease in profits. And some are really heavily hit, like energy coming from a very profitable year, now going to the loss side. Industrials, airlines is one of those, getting hit 81.3%. Consumer discretionaries, I call this the luxury items, the luxury things. They will be losing money. By IT will not lose money. In fact, it will only lose 9% of their profits. We have, of course, the reason online meetings are going on, work from home is going on, and the online education is sweeping the world by storm. Zoom is sweeping the world by storm. That is why IT will still continue to float amidst the pandemic. Consumer staples will not be hard hit, 14.1% only, while financials will lose about half of their profits. What does it tell us? This is number 10 for me. This means that the pandemic is going to tell us a lot of things. And that is, if you want to be profitable, you have to choose the right industry. And the industry, there's so many industries before that used to be recession proof, no more. All right, Jollibee posted loss. It's a food corporation and it suffered a loss in the first quarter. And this is not even the time of the lockdown. Imagine what will be the loss of Jollibee during the first and second quarter of the year. Petron and some of the gas companies also posted losses. Imagine that, you know. I think this is also the same for most of the industries. So you really, if as an entrepreneur, as a businessman, you have to choose the industries and they used to be recession-proof. The companies that used to be recession-proof, they're no more. And there will be changes in the paradigm of business. Okay, so here we are presented about the similarities between the Great Depression and the time before the financial crisis of 2008, we have the top 1% earners getting 25% of the pie, while the top 10% earners getting about 50% of the pie. It was the same in 1928. It was the same in 2007. So you can see the wealth disparity. All the rest of the 90%, you know, are within the 50% of the pie. The disparity is so large, so huge that according to the Forbes magazine, the billionaires, the ones listed in the Forbes billionaires, still managed to increase their wealth during the lockdown, during the pandemic. It's not good. It's not news anymore. We know that it's going to happen. But while a lot of people are dying, we have the wealthy still increasing their wealth. All right. So this is number 9. No goodbye to DIY, and this is brought also by the pandemic in the 1920s. It's also the same. A lot of people would just do their own things, like, of course, cook their own food. Not a lot of people are going out to eat out, you know, eat in the restaurants. They dye their own hair, they cut their own hair, they fix their houses. So it's the same today. So after the pandemic, you will see a resurgence of many industries, like repairing mobile phones, repairing appliances, and domestic economy is at its, I think, finest, especially in places like Indonesia, ASEAN countries, Thailand, Malaysia, and also the Philippines. Number 8, brand is bland. I think what the pandemic taught us is that a lot of people are now shifting brands because of price sensitivity, price concerns. And therefore, we will see that after the pandemic, there will be a lot of good brands that will soon close up. And we can see that in the US, a lot of companies are already filing for bankruptcies. And these are hailed brands. So, you know, you cannot just rely on the brand. You have to do something else in order to survive not only the pandemic, but the new economy. Number seven, leaner is meaner. I mean it. Because if an industry or if a company is lean, it can survive the storm. A company that is lean, and you have the concept of the lean management, less is more. And it doesn't talk about just, you know, getting rid of excess employees or excess numbers of workers. No, it's also leaning the operations, finding ways in order to lean the operations so that the unnecessary things, unnecessary equipment, unnecessary steps are cut short, so that the ones that survive, so to speak, this is some sort of an evolution also. The ones that survive is the one that will bring forth the company to the new economy, to the new normal. This was presented in the first slide, but we have Walmart boosting their income, net income increasing up to 80%. So it's really not the industry per se. Although Walmart is announcing that it's closing some of its shop, that's also one of the ways wherein they combat, you know, the pandemic, and it's also one way of leaning the operations. But this is also a result of the pandemic shifting brands, and also number six, what is essential is not naked to the consumer. You know that this was this is usually an answer among, you know, Miss Universe pageant, Miss Universe candidates. But what I'm focusing is the essentiality of things to buy, and the consumer looking for those essentials and not any more than non-essentials. As you can see in the previous slides, we have the consumer discretionaries down 100.7%, while the consumer staples down only 14%. In fact, Walmart is increasing by 80% in the first quarter. Right? So now for number five, and this is going to sound rather problematic for a lot of people. Yes, you are hearing it right. I'm bringing up Thomas Malthus again. Thomas Malthus, one of the old economists, who said that population increases geometrically while food increases arithmetically, right? So I'm just saying, Malthus is in our ears saying, I told you so. This is going to happen. And it's already happening. It has started happening in Ethiopia, in Africa in 1980s. But, you know, we just simply dismissed them. These stories about poverty and extreme hunger. But now, you know, if you cannot increase the food production geometrically, then you have to curb population. If you cannot do it, nature will. And as you can see, this is the way of nature. Come to think of it, the population problem is real. The population problem is real. That's number five. The population problem is real. First world country, look at the cars lining up for food stamps. We cannot do that in the Philippines. Number one, we don't have a lot of cars. Well, we have a lot of cars, but the poor people, they don't have them, right? And here in a first world country like this one, even the rich people, even the well-to-do, these are the middle income earners, of course, even the well-to-do people, comparing it to the poor country, are lining up for food. In the Philippines, it's also the same, right? Of course, we don't have food stamp, we have ayuda, and of course, the government will spend a lot of money, borrowed money for that matter, in order to feed the population. Why? Because the population problem is real. Look at the Philippines, top three cities of population density. We're not talking only of the population for the whole country. We have about 100 something million but the population density. You know, we have, for example, Manila number one, Pateros number two, Pandaluyong number three. These are the top three cities by population density in the whole world. We have the top three cities, the most populous by in terms of density. Look at Manila, 46,178 in a square kilometer. I cannot imagine having 46,178 within one square kilometer, right? You know, so it's really hard to put social distancing, curb down the propagation of the virus with all these things happening, with all these things at the background. Look at this, number seven, Caloocan, seven, four in the top 10 and seven in the top 25. We have Makati at number 14, Malabon na Botas, number 24, number 25, and we have 13 in the top 50. We are the country with the most cities that are included in this list. Pasig is there, Pasay, San Juan, Marikina, Las Piñas, Quezon City. If you notice, these are the cities in NCR. And that is the reason why we have a lot of COVID-19 cases there. You cannot curb down the propagation of virus if people are, you know, close together, right? Of course, they're not going out of their houses, but in their houses, they are still overpopulated. So, you know, what's the use of doing that when you cannot curb the population density? So really, the balik probinsya of the government is also a way out of this. However, if the people who are coming from NCR already have the virus, when they travel to the province, that's it. That's another problem, right? Population density, COVID-19 problem, and also poverty is there. The Gini coefficient is one of the worst in the world. So yeah, this is brought about by that. Okay, number four, social equity and economic efficiency. This has always been the debate, you know. Should we focus on equity, you know, focusing on alleviating the plight of the poor? Or are we going to build high rise, you know? Let's focus on building the economy, because if we have a lot of jobs, then we will, help the poor. But, you know, look at all these caricatures here. Equality, equity in theory, but because of social justice, this is what's happening. Equity in reality. Social equity, economic efficiency, these are some of the issues and disruptions that that COVID-19 really made us see, because we can see the great divide, the abyss, that's differentiating the well-to-do and the people who really cannot do anything, who cannot even feed themselves, let alone survive for day to day without help from the government. So is there social equity in the world? If we will now propagate that answer and extrapolate that to the rest of the world, look at all this, right? United States has 19.39 trillion, 24.4% of the GDP of the world. China has 15% of the GDP of the world. Japan has 6.13. And look at Europe, the green ones are Europe. And Philippines is somewhere here, about 0.39%. You are wondering if there is social equity. What about if you propagate it to the whole world? So the next idea there is the question about, is wealth a zero-sum game? You know, are we correct in pursuing capitalism? Is there no control with the need of people, you know, to improve and always look for the bottom line and improve their profits? Are we, by becoming wealthy, getting from the poor? Those are questions that have been, you know, bothering us for many, many years. Now, the COVID-19 pandemic has shown us that these must be answered. Because of the COVID-19, also a major disruption is about the ideas of old economies of scale, old economics. We have the picture of Ivan Drago here. You know, eventually, Ivan Drago got knocked out by Rocky, because Rocky is flexible, he's small, is like Rocky Marciano is flexible, and he knocked down Ivan Drago here in this story. So just like in real life, even the big companies are having problems, and it's really, if you look at it, the huge companies are having more problems than the smaller companies, because the smaller companies, like for example, if you have a training company and you are only renting one space, you don't own the space, what will happen during a pandemic? You will just give up the space and you can do your training online, right? So immediately you can decide to move out. Even investments like that, right? You can immediately take out your money, while the mutual funds, which has 100 million or 1 billion assets, you cannot just move your money if you have that kind of money. So you will suffer the loss and you will ride the bears going down, while the smaller companies can be flexible. So that is the reason for the idea of leaning the company or leaning the operations. So the questions for number three is, do we fix the world problems by using 18th century thinking? A lot of the concepts in our economy, economics, this review of economics, 10 principles of economics, the economics that was still written by Adam Smith in the 17th or 18th century. And I think it is time now to look at it again and rewrite history and rewrite economics, because a lot of the things that we are teaching our kids, a lot of the things that we still believe in are economics of the 18th century. So yeah, we should look at the new economics. The new economics as preached by Edwards Deming in 1950s or 1970s, that's not even the new economics that I'm talking about. We are talking about the newest economics, the most current right now, post, the internet bubble of 1999, the World Trade Center bombing in the age of terrorism, and the financial crisis of 2008, right? And now the COVID-19 pandemic and the virus that could be launched, that could easily sweep the world by storm. This is the newer economics that I'm talking about. And the number two is the great divide in education. Here we have, what education looks like in the US during the pandemic. Online education, people have laptops. Well, not everybody, but a majority, Teachers don't have problems with laptops, right? But here we have a picture of, how education is being done in some African country. Education here in the Philippines, teachers needing a loan application just to be provided with laptop, because DepEd needs at least 27 billion to provide everybody with laptops, right? And teachers are asking for internet allowance, because you have a laptop, you don't have internet, that's nothing, because of internet connectivity. That's also the great divide in education. And lastly, I think number one, AI is our why. So Simon Sinek, we have to start with a why. Of course, this countdown is reversed. That's why number one is the last, but AI is our why. Artificial intelligence is here to stay. The major disruption was brought to us by the COVID-19 preached to us the issues, the understanding, the idea, the insights that people can die. Especially if they are the ones manning the triage, the frontliners of hospitals, and a lot of people will unnecessarily die. But look at an AI, manning an hospital, even getting your blood samples and all that. I know that it's not enough. Right now, we cannot still imagine a hospital being run pure AI. Of course, people will still need to be there. There's a need for the caring profession, but eventually you will see that AI is going to take over not only industries, but the caring profession, health, and that is then the major disruption that was accelerated by COVID-19 pandemic. And what do we need to do? in order to proceed further. Looking back at history, we can see that every major disruption that happened, the age of the dinosaurs, the age of the legends, right? And then came, you know, the Spanish flu. When it happened after that, I know World War One is there, but the new economy that was brought about by that, since 1920 to 1950s, and then going to the moon. I don't know if it's true, but going to the moon and the space exploration. Look at all that. And it was brought about by the major disruptions in the world. And what I'm saying is that our major disruption today is the COVID-19. And the way we will respond to this disruption is the why that will give us the reason to proceed to the newer age, the new normal, not only the new normal in terms of our way of life, but the new normal wherein we will elevate our own thinking, and we are going now to proceed into an age wherein we are going to be improving a lot, especially in business, especially in education. So that is our hope, and I just hope that some of the insights that I placed here are going to be taken by you guys, especially the young people, and maybe some of them can inspire researchers, you know, in political science, in social sciences, and especially in education, in engineering, especially AI, and in business. Thank you very much for listening.